A woman ate dark web bought tapeworm eggs to lose weight. This is what happened to her brain. T.E. is a 21-year-old woman presenting to the emergency room with headache, bloating, and severe abdominal pain. She tells the admitting physician that she could feel bumps under her chin that weren't there before, and that a few days ago, she pressed one of these in, and the next thing she could remember was being face down on the floor. T.E. often browsed magazines. She'd look at the images and just wonder why. Why can't she be the one in the picture? In her mind, these magazines spoke directly to her, saying, "Oh, what's wrong? Why don't you look like this?" And she interpreted this as needing to do anything so that she could look like that. She tried dieting, but every time she did it, she'd immediately start on an ultra-intense regimen and she couldn't stick with it. She tried extreme exercise, but to her, it seemed like nothing would work. One evening, T.E. was on a picture-sharing platform. She came across a diet blog post. The account said that someone had messaged them about a controversial weight loss method, and the account said that they reported the message because clearly, it was such a dangerous and terrible method to lose weight that it should never be uttered. "We definitely should never even give this any attention because it's so heinous." But in the comments, someone replied that dangerous is irrelevant. They wanted to get in touch with whoever that was because they wanted to try it. This suspicious post reeked of intense social engineering from what appeared to be a manufactured disagreement by trolls trying to profit off morbid curiosity, but T.E. was intrigued. A forbidden method is one that must be so good and so powerful that it's the one true secret that she needs to know. She dug a little deeper and was directed exactly where to go for more information. On the suspicious Onion website, T.E. was getting influenced. Symbiosis is imperative to survival. We must work together to survive on a world that's trying to eliminate us. Look at the clownfish and anemone. The fish gets shelter from the anemone, and in return it brings food for the anemone. This is kind of like tapeworms and humans. The worms take shelter in our stomach. Rather than bring us food, they eat our extras, helping us lose weight. And they're just a worm. They can't do anything bad. Clearly, this win-win situation was beneficial, with absolutely no risks at all for all parties involved, as this website spoke directly to T.E. This is definitely for her. At first, she was repulsed, but she read about and saw pictures of the alleged success stories. She became convinced this was not only the best path for her situation, but the only, most cost-effective path because everything else she's tried failed. She started chatting with some people on a server, and they instructed her how to obtain and use special coins to purchase these eggs. She paid, and a VIP package from a special administrative port city was expedited to her. And when the small, nondescript box arrived, her heart started racing. Looking at the capsules, she started getting the creeps. She could smell something going on in the bottle, but she wasn't sure what it was. She believed that inside each one of these capsules was the true path to her new self, with the help of some new, soon-to-be-hatched friends, who she'll also be benefiting because they'll be living rent-free with all meals paid for. She put two capsules in her mouth and swallowed them down. As the days passed, T.E. felt nothing. She ate normally, but sometimes she'd feel weird cramping in her stomach that would quickly go away. When she stepped on the scale, she started noticing that number was going down, something she never saw before. She even tried to go all out to eat more than she normally would, and number would still go down. This magical weight loss was totally unlike anything she had ever tried before, but something was wrong. One evening, T.E. went to the bathroom. This time was kind of weird because she thought she could feel something flapping and slapping around her cheeks while she was sitting down. When she was about to flush, she looked back and saw some tan, rectangular pieces floating around in the bowl, creeping out of the bulk mass. They kind of looked like the ginger that you eat with sushi, but she hadn't eaten any sushi recently. T.E. felt like she was going to have a panic attack, but she was able to convince herself that all of this was just weight leaving her body. Eventually, T.E. noticed that her weight loss had stalled out. Concerned that she had plateaued, she looked back to the capsules that she still had left, and she committed herself. It was time to add more rent-free tenants inside. Immediately after swallowing a third tapeworm egg capsule, T.E. felt confident. Time to lose some more weight, she thought, and everything was fine. But a few weeks later, something was wrong. One evening, T.E. felt that there were bumps under her chin. When she pressed one of them in, the next thing she could remember was that she was face down on the floor. And when she got up, she could feel pressure immediately swell in her face, like something was pushing her eyes out of her skull. The next day, T.E. woke up with a massive headache. Throughout the day, the hurt would pulsate, each time more intense than the last. But finally, the pain was too much as she's brought to the emergency room, where we are now. At examination, T.E. physically looked okay. When doctors took a scan of her head, they thought it looked normal. Maybe a higher resolution scan can give them some more clues, but T.E. declined. She didn't want to wait several hours to sit in a machine that could tell them nothing, so she asked if there was anything else that they could do instead. The brain is protected by something called the meninges, a liquid called the cerebrospinal fluid, CSF, sits between two meningeal layers, providing cushion and supporting normal blood flow for the brain. CSF flows into the brain, and it's contained inside a closed space. If TE has a headache, then it's possible that her CSF pressure is either really high, swelling into her brain, or it's really low. Because it's cerebrospinal fluid, the medical team put a needle into her spine to take a sample of the CSF. This helps them collect it so that they can analyze it in the lab, but they can also check the pressure of it, and when they look, it was more than double of normal. But why was it so high? Well, it's in a closed space, so if things get into the CSF that aren't supposed to be there, they'll take up space. That increases pressure. What could those things be? One of them could be sugar. The interesting thing about sugar is that wherever it is, water will flow towards it, causing swelling. She could possibly be a diabetic having a crisis, meaning that sugar is everywhere in her blood, getting into her CSF. But when the medical team looked, they didn't find sugar in her CSF. Sometimes white blood cells can get in and take up extra space. This could mean that there's a bacterial or fungal infection, but they didn't find any white blood cells either. The exception is sometimes a viral infection won't increase white blood cell count in the CSF at first, and figuring out a virus can be harder than the others. So they weren't able to really confirm what was happening. But the pressure was high no matter what. TE was started on an IV drip with special fluid. This liquid draws water out of the brain and puts it into the blood. This relieved her headache because it decreased the pressure inside. Combined with antiviral medicine, this fixed everything. The doctors never asked her about any suspicious things she may have taken in the past, and she wasn't going to tell them anyways because, like the Onion website said, worms would only take shelter in her gut. They found nothing else wrong with her, and she was sent home and feeling okay. But the headaches didn't actually go away. At home, no matter how much or how little she'd eat, TE would feel bloated. Her head would randomly start pounding, and each time the new wave of pain came battering into her skull, her vision would start to blur. Sometimes she'd huddle over the toilet, scared that the friends inside her stomach would emerge, but nothing ended up happening. As weeks turned into months, TE could feel strange bumps in her head and her neck. Most of them weren't painful, but hardly any of them got smaller. She'd have periods in time where she'd suddenly wake up in the middle of the day, unsure if she had lost consciousness or something, because she'd be so confused and she couldn't remember anything from the last few hours as she's brought back to the emergency room again. There's no shortcut to meaningfully lose weight and be healthy. You still need to dial in your diet and exercise. For the exercise part, Trainwell, formerly Co-Pilot Fitness, can help with that, and they're the sponsor of this video. It's a combination personal trainer, a real human who tailors a training program for you that's monitored during each session and followed up on several times weekly, and a system that tracks your training progress. You're accountable to stay on track, and they teach you how to be in control of your fitness. I pay for Trainwell, and here's how it works. First, they ask you for some quick info about you, about your goals, and what you're looking for in context of fitness. Then they use that to match you with a coach. When I started with Trainwell in late 2023, I matched with Coach AJ. He's awesome, but don't worry, you can also change your coach at any time. I wanted to try that out, so after a few months, I matched with Coach Adam, and we talk training program at least 5 times a week. Quick messages to make sure that we're on track. Your coach tailors the workout plan for you, and that's where it ties in to the app. I go to the gym. The app links my phone and watch if you have it. Now you're monitored to track progress, heart rate, movement, reps, pace during each set. It shows you how to do each exercise. Plus, Coach plans your workouts entirely and tracks your activity, keeping you accountable. Exercise and fitness are celebrations of being able to move in the function that you have. Trainwell helps me realize that goal. There's something here for everybody in context of exercise, whether or not you have prior gym experience. The first 100 people to sign up with my Trainwell, formerly Co-Pilot link, gets 14 days free and $25 off their first month with their own personal trainer. At examination this time, doctors felt the bumps on her body. She told them that during the day, she'd wake up and realize that she was on the ground and couldn't remember the last few hours, and her headaches from a few months ago never really went away. All of these prompted them to take a closer look at her brain. an MRI revealed multiple lesions all over T.E.'s brain. They found similar lesions all over her neck, face, and tongue. More spots were found on her liver, and they were on her spine. All of this was coupled with high cerebrospinal fluid pressure again. T.E.'s tapeworms should still be in her stomach. The specific ones that she bought can grow to 4 to 12 meters in length, sometimes as long as 25 meters. Small dots on a brain scan aren't several meters long worms in the gut, so what was happening? Doctors asked T.E. what she had been eating. She told them potato chips. They asked her about her hygiene, but she gave no indications that she had poor hygiene. In the back of her mind, T.E. had a suspicion that her problems are because of the tapeworm eggs. She felt embarrassed about it, but after all of the persistent questioning, she finally showed the doctors the capsules that she had taken. When the doctor looked at the bottle, it was labeled saginata, and this gives them some clues as to what's happening. Saginata refers to Tinea saginata, also known as beef tapeworm. Humans and cows often live together on farms. Cows eat vegetation, but like anything that you find on the ground, sometimes that vegetation might have been touched by feces, which can contain parasite eggs. Cows have multiple stomachs, and Tinea saginata parasite becomes nourished in this environment. The oncospheres hatch. They migrate into muscle tissue in a form called cystocerci, where they live for years. And when humans eat undercooked beef from that cow, the cystocerci enter the human gut, where they develop into an adult tapeworm latching on to the human intestine. Tinea tapeworms are made of segments called proglottids. As the adult worms mature, the proglottids can become gravid, from Latin gravis, meaning heavy, but in this context meaning loaded, in this case, pregnant, with eggs, as the worm uses humans for the final part of its life cycle. These gravid proglottids rip off and get ejected out of the human host. The sushi ginger that T.E. thought she saw in the bowl that day was actually gravid proglottids, and the flapping and slapping that she felt were those pregnant segments creeping out. These eggs then make their way into the environment and back into a cow's stomachs, completing the circle. This infection is called teniasis. It explains T.E.'s gastrointestinal symptoms and her weight loss, but those aren't why she presented to the emergency room. These worms stay in the gut, but something is in her brain, and it's in her face and her tongue and the rest of her body. They're not worms, rather they kind of look like eggs. So what's going on? Well, cows aren't the only farm animals. They're also not the only animal that can be an intermediate host to tapeworms. Pigs have been with us for a very long time, but given that pig guts are very different from cow guts, then it means that if a tapeworm were to spend formative parts of its life cycle in one animal versus the other, then there could be two different species of tapeworm, maybe somewhat related, not only slightly different in not only how they behave, but also a little different in life cycle as well. And the pork tapeworm, known as Tinea solium, does all of this, and part of its life cycle causes more than teniasis. But how different is that life cycle exactly? Well, when humans eat undercooked pork from a Tinea solium infected pig, they eat oncospheres that were in the muscle tissue, and this is what becomes the worm in the human gut. That worm releases tapeworm eggs in the human's stool, and it's here where the life cycle differs from beef tapeworm. The eggs released into the environment by human feces can be eaten by pigs, completing the cycle, but these Tinea solium eggs can also be eaten by humans, too. They absorb into the gut. They don't become mature worms. Rather, they do what they do in pigs. They float around in the body and embed themselves into soft tissue like the skin, the muscles, the tongue, and the brain. This blocks flow and disrupts normal function. Beef tapeworm doesn't do this. When T.E. took the first two tapeworm capsules, she went several months feeling okay, minus some abdominal symptoms. During this time, tapeworm grew in her gut. It ate her food. It caused her abdominal pain and discomfort. It's possible that these were all Tinea saginata eggs. But given her seizures and her headache and the bumps all over her body, and knowing that solium and not saginata causes those problems, it means that there was definitely more than just saginata in this bottle. And this infection is called cysticercosis. Do you remember her high cerebrospinal fluid pressure? Well, cystocerci often embed into the brain. Sometimes they can crawl their way into the subarachnoid space where the cerebrospinal fluid is, and because the extra space taken up increases the pressure, it causes a mass effect. This could happen without triggering increases in protein or sugar in the CSF, which explains why the medical team didn't find anything when they did the lumbar puncture that one time. It explains her headaches, and the cysts may have still been small or in a place where they didn't take a scan. Involvement of the brain makes this neurocysticercosis. Do you remember that TE would randomly regain consciousness during the day? Well, those were seizures. When someone suddenly loses consciousness like that, they can fall and break their bones or hit their head. If no one is around in the ladder, everything could be over. This brings us to the idea of weighing risk to benefit. In able-bodied individuals, weight loss can be achieved by diet and exercise together. The cost involved is time, commitment, and know-how, with the benefit being weight loss. So this end result can be achieved without taking anything special. However, sometimes that cost is too high for some, so they'll take a risk by taking something special to get the benefit. And this risk is where some problems can start to emerge. A long-term study followed patients who had neurocysticercosis. Their symptoms were severe, like weakness on one side of the body, numbness, double vision, or vision loss, because tapeworm cysts were all over their brain. You would think that medicines would solve their problem, no more brainworms, and that was the case, but years, even decades would go by, and they would slowly or suddenly experience permanent vision changes, personality changes, diminished cognitive functions. Imaging would show that the cysts degenerated. The medicine did do some work on them, but they never really went away. None of this would have happened had the tinea solium never gotten into their body in the first place, but these cases were accidental infections. TEs was deliberate, and the benefit of losing some weight does not outweigh these permanent risks that can happen. When the medical team asked TE when she ate these eggs, they realized that this is something that happened recently, over the last year. She may have had tinea saginata and tinea solium tapeworms in her body, but the cysts that had lodged into her brain and the rest of her body were very likely the latter. Figuring out the species probably wouldn't be cost-effective because the medicine to treat both is the same. TE was given praziquantel. This medicine forces calcium into the tapeworm's muscles. Because muscle contractions use calcium as the confirmatory signal, loading a huge amount of calcium into the tapeworm forces its muscles to contract, and it can't stop contracting. This forces the worm to detach from the gut. A second medicine, albendazole, was given. This starves the parasite of sugar and depletes its energy, destroying it. Because dead worms would be in her brain, steroids were given to her to limit her body's inflammatory reaction. These are the same medicines that were given to the long-term patients. While this treatment's goals are to eliminate the cysts, it's always possible that the body doesn't fully eliminate them, leaving calcified masses to develop over time, which can cause problems even decades later, despite TE not having any new exposure to tinea tapeworm ever again. As the days and weeks passed for treatment, TE started to get better. The seizures stopped and additional scans revealed that cysts were no longer in her brain. After 3 weeks, she was doing well enough to go home. TE learned her lesson about tapeworm eggs for weight loss. While her source was questionable, something like this is always going to be questionable no matter where from. This is way more risk than benefit, especially given that it's not imperative that you must take something to lose weight. In an able-bodied human, weight loss with diet and exercise is physically doable, and that has much less risk than letting organisms intentionally live inside of you to accomplish that goal. At follow-up 6 months later, TE was in good spirits. She had not taken any more tapeworm eggs and was able to lose and maintain a healthy weight all on her own accord, as she was able to make a full recovery. Thanks so much for watching. Take care of yourself and be well. And check out Trainwell, link in the description below.